the way I hate you.
Hi, my name is David Poland. I'd like to welcome you to Portland Film Beat. Tonight, my guest is Julie Christine Sullivan. She's a writer, a producer, and an actress. And I'm going to let her tell us about herself because she's got a lot to say. Anyway, where did you train?
I got my training at Pepperdine University.
Oh, aren't you lucky?
Yes, I was pretty fortunate. It was the last, I guess, year and a half of schooling. I had gone to three schools prior to that and kind of found my niche in film. And I was at there, Pepperdine, at an exciting time when they were building this huge studio and they were taking communication to a whole new place where there
you
was
don't
practical.
Usually hear Pepperdine as a film school.
No, and it wasn't at the time. It really wasn't film. It was really digital video production, and they had a great broadcasting major as well that I wasn't a part of. I was part of the production.
Okay, right. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But it was fantastic, and I got hands-on experience with all different kinds of studio equipment and field equipment, cameras, and.
Did you take writing classes there?
I didn't take writing classes actually. For my senior project was to write and produce a 7-minute short, and everyone in the class had to do it, and then they had to pitch their project and try to get other classmates to jump on board their project.
Okay.
So I got up and I did my pitch for my short, and people were thrilled to jump on board. And mm-hmm. when I handed in my script for the short, my instructor, Susan Salas, and the guest instructor, who is Greg Bonin, who's a writer, director, producer, he was co-creator of Baywatch, really took me aside and said, you know, you've got something here. There's talent here that you need to nurture. So I just kind of fell into it that way. It was something
nice.
I had to do.
And you were encouraged then by...
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Okay, yeah, it was fantastic.
Did you always want to make films?
I always wanted to be a part of making movies and okay. television, actually. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what that would look like, you know, until college, but... Mm-hmm. I fancied myself being an actress like Julia Roberts in some kind of Gary Marshall movie, and I don't know. I didn't know what it was going to look like. I didn't know what my career was
okay,
going to look
so
like.
How did you get from Pepperdine to Portland?
Oh, well, that was a very long and windy journey. The years after Pepperdine actually were difficult. It was hard for me to get a job in entertainment. So I actually bounced around the country for a little bit.
Okay.
I ended up in Maine for a little while. I pursued medical school for a little while. And then I would always return to Los Angeles.
Okay.
To give it one more shot. You know, and I slept, you know, out of my car and on floors to just try to make it happen. Finally, I had gotten a job at Warner Brothers, which was my lifelong dream to work there. In 2008, I got the opportunity. But it was really lacking because I was on the business side. I was on the corporate side of making television.
Right.
And it wasn't what I wanted to do.
Okay.
So then I met Charlie Vaughn, and this is after Spinster and after quite a bit of time. But Charlie moved to Portland and said, you know, this would be a really great atmosphere to make the kind of movies that you want to make and stay independent. And they really foster a creative
spirit. Okay, so that's what got
spirit.
You here.
Yeah, that's what got me here. Yes.
So is Charlie kind of a partner of yours in Happily Ever Spinster and 33 as well, right?
Right. Well, Charlie and I have been dear friends for quite some time. And Charlie kind of got into directing and filmmaking before I did, while I was at Warner Brothers. Okay. And he was kind of the instigator to get me started, you know, pursuing the creativity.
Right.
And making movies.
Okay. Yeah. So, what did you do before you actively pursued writing and producing?
Well, I spent, most recently, I was at Warner Brothers, and I was doing contract drafting mm-hmm. for A-list talent on our TV shows. And, you know, that was fine, but it wasn't creative. It didn't get my, you know, juices flowing.
Okay,
so.
Cool.
But before then, it was a lot of trying to get in the door.
Okay.
A lot of heartbreak, a lot of soul-crushing experiences, but, you know.
All right. Tell us the premise of Happily Ever Spinster.
Happily Ever Spinster follows the adventures, or maybe misadventures as it were, of an unlucky in love girl named Zoe and her best friend,
okay,
Mark.
So the picture behind me is actually you with a bandage,
yes,
on your head. Let's be clear that is actually not domestic abuse.
No,
right?
No, it's not domestic abuse. No, not at all. I would never promote that.
Okay, I know.
No, it's self-abuse, actually. In this picture, you can't see it very clearly, but my character had just taken quite a big dive off of a treadmill.
Oh, is that right?
Yes. And she's awkward at best.
Okay.
And things.
So is that part of the premise of the story? We're gonna watch it here, the trailer in a second. But
right.
Go ahead.
Sort of. That she's just an awkward human being, and her experiences with dating are quite a bit humiliating. And she seems to crash and burn, and even literally, obviously.
Right. So how did you develop the storyline?
Well, it's actually based on a blog that I used to have. Charlie was a big fan, and when I was telling him that I missed being creative and I wanted to be on set and make something, he said, well, hey, you know, why don't you write me a short, you know, 20 pages or so based on your blog. That's hilarious. So I pulled together a couple that, you know, were about my dating experiences as a single girl. So it's sort of based on a true story,
okay.
Maybe slightly embellished.
That's okay.
But yeah, that's how it came to be. And I wrote it in an afternoon on a Sunday when I probably should have been in church. And I sent it to Charlie, and he's like, "I love it. Let's make it." And it was still about 2 years
okay.
until we
you
did.
What? We're actually going to take a few moments right
yeah.
now, and we're going to watch the trailer for Happily Ever Spinster, mm-hmm. and we'll be right back.
Are reaching the age where your lady parts start to rebel against you and your eggs shrivel up and die.
You must be Mark Zoe. I've heard a lot about you.
Okay, listen here, Sister Mary Marcus. The point is, I think I'm calling it a day on this whole dating business.
What about online dating?
Isn't it like being a pimp?
Well, yeah, except without the cane and feathered fedora and much less backhand.
You ever seen all the way inside someone's poop chute?
What did you just say?
Please don't tell me I'm trying to pick up a guy over my possibly paraplegic body.
Don't you want somebody to keep your bed warm at night?
I can get a cat. I can get 10.
No, he's straight. I mean, you are straight, right?
All right. I had a coupon that was about to expire.
Why would you or anyone need a mariachi band in a park?
Well, you know, because you're Mexican.
This isn't a quinceañera. You know, I'm a little older than a quinceañera.
I actually think I need to go to the emergency room.
To the boys who have no idea what they're in for.
And to us.
To us.
That was fun to watch. I'm looking forward to seeing the short. Is it 20 minutes long?
It's 21 minutes 45 seconds.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a longer short, but you know, it's drastically reduced from the original 38.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah, I kind of got out of control when I was doing rewrites, and I was like, "Oh, let's just add this line and that line."
Yeah,
this
you
is
do.
Too
it's
funny.
Easy it's easy to add stuff to.
Absolutely.
And then a lot of it you have to take out.
Unfortunately, there are a lot of good one-liners that we did.
Yeah, you got to kill your what they call it, you know, get rid of the things that you really love, because
right.
that doesn't mean everybody else does.
Well, I mean, I hope they would. Maybe we can do like an extended or something.
So what are a few things you learned by making Happily Ever Spinster?
Oh, well, first of all, I think I learned that I could actually survive making a film.
Okay.
I mean, it's not for the faint of heart. I was basically thrown into executive producing this thing with very little experience. And so raising the money and getting people to support it and getting them involved and all of that jazz and not killing each other and not getting too emotional. Sometimes that worked out, sometimes that didn't.
It does, yeah.
But, you know, at the end of the day, we had a beautiful film that I was immensely proud of. But literally, a little bit of blood, a lot of sweat, and a lot of tears went into making this film. But,
nice, okay.
But we came out okay.
Well, describe the appeal you think that Happily Ever Spinster will have with audiences, and why?
Okay, well, I think that it's, we have some relatable characters. You know, they're ordinary. There's nothing too special about them. And okay. I think that audiences could really relate to the strife that goes into the dating scene. Everyone has probably a horror story or whatnot, or a humiliating experience.
More than one, yeah.
Yes, or sometimes 5 or 6 or 12. Mm-hmm. But I think it's important to have relatable content for the mm-hmm. audience. You know, it's fun to have the fantastical, but sometimes you gotta bring it back down to earth and mm-hmm. say this is what real life is all about.
Okay, so how does a happily ever spinster distinguish itself from other films in this genre? It's not a chick flick.
I wouldn't say it's a chick flick. No. I think it's about you know, any kind of any individual, whether female or male, gay, straight, whatever, you know, we all kind of go through the same experiences of mm-hmm. life, and it's all trying to make a connection and realizing the support we have all around us. I don't think it's a chick flick.
So there's another film you're working on called 33.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about that one.
33 is really a departure of kind of what I've been known to make, which is comedy. 33 is a very heavy drama. And it was made at a time, actually written here in Portland. Last summer, I was going through a difficult time. You know, there was a lot of changes in life, and my 30s weren't really as wonderful as everyone had said that they would be. And there were a lot of questions about, you know, well, you're a woman and you're in your 30s, and so why don't you have these things that typically women in their 30s should have? A husband, right. A child, a thriving career. And I think there's a lot of pressure
right.
still in these days to have those things. And so it was kind of dealing with inner conflict and the outer conflict of, you know, traditional ways of thinking versus modern versus, you know, feminine strength, and just kind of trying
so
to deal with everything.
So do you think that sometimes it's women that put the pressures on other women for the, why don't you have kids? Why aren't you married? Why don't you have the career?
Maybe.
More so than men?
I wouldn't.
Or just society in general?
I think society in general, you know, we all have parents, and most of us do. And, you know, we have that older generation that's from a different time where, you know, by the time you're 25, you should be on your first marriage and first child, at least.
Yeah.
I have been.
My mom had her first kid at 19.
Yeah. Oh my goodness. Yeah. I couldn't even imagine.
That was years ago, right?
I could not even imagine. I've always been like the black sheep of my family. You know, just you know, everyone else in my family was on their first marriage and child by the time they were 25. Okay. And me, you know, I was busy pursuing my career and pursuing what I had passions that lay outside of that
okay.
that whole realm. So
why don't we watch a little bit of that 33, huh?
Okay, sure.
We're going to take a few minutes right now, and we're going to watch the trailer for 33. It's only 30 seconds long, and we'll be right back.
Why do your 30s have to be so difficult?
I can't believe you're still there. You know, you belong here.
I don't belong anywhere.
That was another fun thing to watch.
Was it fun?
Yeah, it was fun. You know, and that's, was it Kelsey?
Yes, Kelsey was in it, and Kelly Holloway.
Okay.
Great supporting actresses who lent their mm-hmm. talent. 33 was special in that we really didn't have a budget.
So what was your role in 33?
33, again, I was executive producer, writer, and lead actress.
Really? Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So since, what's the gentleman's name, Charlie?
Charlie, my
director. Is he
director?
The director?
Yes.
What's he like working with him as a director, since you've known him so long?
Uh-huh. Charlie, I knew Charlie was wonderful, I knew he was immensely talented, and Charlie is exceptionally giving as a director. And also, I mean, especially in comedy,
okay.
he knew how to take the script that I had given him to another level.
Okay.
He knew how to add in things that would just give it that extra punch.
Okay, good.
And I love that. And I love watching the way he works with and respects his actors and his crew. And he's really taught me a lot about respect on a set.
So Happily Ever Spinster and 33, did you have, how big of a crew did you have for each one of those films?
They were very small.
You had a camera guy, or
was No, it wasn't Charlie. We had a DP for both, Jeff Gallion, who was great on Happily Ever Spinster, and then we had Mark Eifert, who has done some teaching at the Northwest Film Center.
Okay.
And has been making films for a while.
Did you have a sound person?
We did. We had, yes, Nels Christensen was our sound for Happily Ever Spinster. And then a good friend and colleague that I've worked with a couple of times, Dave Ross, came up to do the sound for 33.
Oh, he came up here to do
it? He did, yes. Unfortunately.
Is he like from Pepperdine or LA?
No, he's from Los Angeles. He is the one crew member that I had to bring up from Los Angeles because I didn't get any responses for a sound guy up here. So bless his heart, he drove from Long Beach, California
to
Portland.
That's a 9-hour drive.
Overnight.
No, that's a 16-hour drive.
Yes. Overnight he did that for me. And
oh, you owe him a lot.
I do. I absolutely
did. You buy him coffee?
Yes. Okay. Yes. I'll buy him whatever he wants and I'll work on whatever he wants from here on out.
How many films have you made?
I have produced 5. I've written or co-written 4.
Okay, great. Yeah. So what are your strengths as a writer and filmmaker?
Well, I think as a writer, it's really important to be able to imagine what it is that you're writing in detail. And I think it really helps the director or whoever else is collaborating with you on the project to see what the vision is on paper. Some directors don't like it so wordy, so they can kind of take it wherever they want to take it. Charlie has been very, very wonderful in the fact that he knows my vision and he knows my words and he knows what I like and he's very understanding about how I write. So it's been a really great collaboration. As far as a filmmaker goes, I think I have total respect for everyone that sets foot on my set.
That's good.
Complete respect and what they bring to the game and their talent, and I do my best to stay out of their way.
So what are your weaknesses then as a filmmaker?
Oh boy. Well, I can say that I haven't mastered that, the mentality of, you know, not caring what anyone thinks, because I really do care what people think. Mm-hmm. And I want to,
you know, here's something somebody said to me that really changed me. What other people think of you is none of your business.
That's absolutely true.
If you look at it that way, that's none of my business, what you said.
Absolutely
good
true.
Good or bad. Yeah. It really changes you. So I want you to start thinking of it that way.
It's really none of my business what you think of me.
It's none of your business what
they say. Absolutely.
It'll change you. I hope so.
I try to please everyone, but I do realize that I can't. And at some point, I have to get out of my own way.
You know what? Do the story. Make it all about the story and forget everything else.
Right.
And then it's going to make good films. What is your greatest challenge as roadblocks? What are your greatest challenges and roadblocks in embarking on this career?
I guess the biggest challenge was taking that leap of faith and going from the stability of a weekly paycheck.
Yeah, and that is a big leap.
To not having a weekly paycheck. That's been hard. It's a really unstable career path to follow, you know, especially getting started. So that's been difficult. And of course, you know, along with that, when there are the lulls in the work in between films, there's a lot of self-doubt that comes in. And did I make the right choice? Am I on the right path?
It seems like the self-doubt never goes away once, you know, it's like there all the time.
I really wish it would.
It doesn't. You just got to deal with it all the time.
You know, I think sometimes it's important, though, to see yourself through other people's eyes. And sometimes, you know, they see you greater than you are, and it kind of lifts your spirit. Or I'm speaking about you, but like me.
It does me too.
I have really supportive friends.
Good. That's great. You need that. Oh, yeah. My wife is so supportive, and my kids. Oh,
that's fantastic.
I cannot tell you how supportive they are. They're just awesome.
I think it's essential to have that kind of support sometimes.
I mean, she shows up and does executive producing for this show every week. Yeah.
That a girl.
Isn't she awesome?
That a girl, yes.
So what are your greatest triumphs so far?
You know, it might sound a little egotistical, but I think the triumphs lie in completing these films. I left that job at Warner Brothers so that I could make movies, and here I've done it.
Right.
And I'm really proud of that, and I'm really proud of the project.
You should be proud of that.
Thank you so much. Last year when I was writing 33, I had said to myself, I will make this by the fall, and I was writing it towards the beginning of the summer. And lo and behold, we got it done. It was right at the end of fall, but we got it shot and made. And
so what is your favorite part of filmmaking?
Being on set.
Is that right?
That's really my happy place. Absolutely.
Okay, what is your favorite part of writing?
Oh my goodness. Well, I like it all, but I really like it when I get on a roll. You know, I'll think of
sometimes it just flows from you. Other days
Absolutely.
You're at war with it, other days it just
right.
flows.
Yes, and when I get 7 pages and I don't even realize 7 pages have just flown by and I've nailed a scene or dialogue or brought something together, it just feels like such a big, huge accomplishment.
It does.
Yeah.
So what's your least favorite thing?
Oh gosh, funding. Funding is the worst, David. I have to tell you.
You actually got funding. That's great.
Well, yeah, we were very lucky. I did a crowdfund for both. I did a crowdfund from the get-go for Happily Ever Spinster, and we did it at a time when Zach Braff was funding his I Wish I Was Here or There or wherever he wishes he was. he got $1.5 million in a day.
I know.
And it took me 4 weeks to get $800. And that was a little disheartening.
I'm sure.
But luckily, you know, our total budget for that movie was $4,500. And with the help of numerous supporters and a private investor, we reached our goal. And we made it happen. 33, I did crowdfunding after the fact for finishing costs, and we just about made it. So, right.
So what is your favorite screenplay
that I've written, or
no? What is your favorite screenplay of
somebody else's?
Yeah. Can define you as a writer, in my opinion.
I really enjoy Nora Ephron's When Harry Met Sally.
Is that right?
I think it's gorgeous. I think it's smart.
Great.
The way she wrote for a female. Just it's spot on. But I also just recently wrote, and it's a big departure, but The Way Way Back by Nat Faxon and Jim Rash. Mm-hmm. And I read the screenplay while I was watching the movie just to see how it translated, and it was great. It was perfect. I love doing that. I love when movies stay true to their script as much as they possibly can.
Right, because there's the movie you write, the movies you shoot, and then
right, exactly
the movie you edit.
Mm-hmm.
Which actually editing is rewriting the story in a
absolutely.
Way.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Who's your favorite director?
Oh, I would say that's a tie. That's a tie between John Hughes and Nora Ephron.
Okay,
absolutely.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I'm all about the chick power.
Any aspirations to direct down the line? You know, later on, are you looking to do it?
You know, I think maybe that might be in the cards. You know, Nora was special in that she said, you know, when you're a writer and you can visualize a movie, that's like half the battle. You're halfway there, you know, as a writer.
Okay.
'Cause you see it in your mind, and then it's just kind of practically making it work.
Right, okay.
So, I think maybe, possibly. A lot of learning to do, though.
Okay, so who or what inspires you?
I would say everyday life, everyday people.
Right. Okay. Good.
And the stories of just
that's what kind of have Happily Ever Spinster, everyday people.
Absolutely. I think, you know, people are really interesting. And their experiences are really interesting. They might be somewhat similar, but then there's just this little tick that kind of like sets them apart from the rest. And it's if you give them time to experience their life and see it all unfold. It's really quite, sometimes it's harrowing, sometimes it's comedic, sometimes it's dramatic, and you take it all, the good, the bad, what have you.
Name a couple of your favorite films.
My favorite films. Okay, so When Harry Met Sally,
okay,
obviously.
Got it, yeah.
I love the John Hughes flicks. I love Breakfast Club. I could watch that over and over on loop.
Really? I couldn't.
Really?
No, I couldn't.
Oh my goodness. John Hughes is great. What are you talking about?
I like
about?
John Hughes, but I couldn't watch
Breakfast
Club a couple of times.
Oh, David.
I know, sorry.
That's okay. Mm-hmm. I'm a girl. I have different
what
tastes.
What inspiration did you you must have drawn inspiration from those films then?
Absolutely.
For especially looking at Happily Ever Spinster.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I think what I'm most drawn to in movies is the relatability of characters.
Okay.
And that's what I strive to do in whatever I write, you know, make sure that the audience can relate to these characters, that they're real, real people going through real things. And I think if you have that, that's a fantastic movie. Plus, you know, great one-liners.
There you go.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So is there a common type of film genre that you relate to the most? I guess John Hughes films and things like that, right?
I do like comedy and drama. I like it when there's a healthy mix of both
right.
within a movie. I do also, I'm a sucker for a good holiday movie.
Oh, really?
I realize that. Yeah, Home for the Holidays. Okay. Oh, my God, it's hilarious with Holly Hunter mm-hmm. and Robert Downey Jr., Family Stone. Okay. I like feel-good movies, and I do, contrary to what I've made with Happily Ever Spinster and Maybe 33, is that I really do like happy endings. I'm a really happy person.
Okay. So, what A-list talented actor, director would you like to work with?
Oh, my gosh, there's so many. Well, of course, the great Meryl Streep and Sally Field and Shirley MacLaine and Jodie Foster as a director and an actress. I really dig what Ben Affleck has done with movies as well. There's just a handful. I would love to work with, like, Steve Carell, you know, act against him. And I would say that I would love to act against Will Ferrell,
too. Steve Carell, I'm telling you, you know, excuse me.
Sure.
From the 40-year-old version to mm-hmm. The Way, Way Back.
Yeah.
And then again, Foxcatcher.
Yes.
Holy, I didn't even hardly recognize him in Foxcatcher.
You know, he's something to be admired for, like, the way he can do comedy and drama. You know, sometimes it's hit and miss with actors trying to do both. Steve Carell nails it. Right. So, you know, I would also like to work with Will Ferrell, but I think, you know, 70 takes in of laughing, I'd probably get fired. But, yeah. You know, that'd be a fun set to be on.
It'd be hard not to laugh,
though. Right.
I'm surprised that, you know, they probably have to do it a few times so people get to laugh out. Oh, of course. And you do it and you don't have to laugh.
Of course.
We're going to have to finish up here pretty quick.
Yeah.
But what's next for you, Julie?
Well, right now it's just completing 33. And also right now I'm working on a follow-up to Happily Ever Spinster because our audiences have been really... really interested in what happens next on that journey. Mm-hmm. And then there's my first feature script that I'm working on. It's called Back and Through Line, mm-hmm. about a writer whose career stalls and she's forced to move in with her mother and surly grandmother and kind of deal with those family dynamics. Mm-hmm. It's a dramedy.
Okay, cool.
So, yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay. We're running out of time here at Portland Film Beat. I want to thank you for tuning in. I want to thank Julie for showing up and sharing her stories about her adventures to becoming a filmmaker. Mm. I want to thank Ellery Nelson, who's the director. I want to thank Phil and Sue Holmes, who are my assistant directors. I want to thank Emily Rowland and Kate Richards down at Portland Community Media. They've helped me a lot. I also want to thank Christo and Krista. Krista really is a big help here down at TVC TV. And until next time on Portland Film Beat, shoot for the silver screen.